We begin this afternoon's victory service in the name of our triune God, in the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us join our hearts together in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you that you sent your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, into this world to be our substitute. He was placed under your law and kept it perfectly in thought, word, and deed for us. That perfection is now ours through faith in him. He also willingly went to the cross to suffer and die and experience the God-forsakenness of hell for us, thereby paying the guilt and punishment of all of our sins. He then triumphantly rose from the dead, assuring us of a resurrection to everlasting life with you. We praise you, Savior Jesus, for this victory as we celebrate the victory of life over death for our beloved sister, Betty Nolting. Comfort each of us with the same assurance, and in our deaths, give us that same victory of everlasting life. We ask this in your saving name. Amen. We'll continue with hymn 371.
Thank you.
The obituary of Betty Jean Nolting. Romans 6, 4, and 5. We were therefore buried with him by this baptism into his death, so that just as he was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too would also walk in a new life. For if we have been united with him in the likeness of his death, we will certainly also be united with him in the likeness of his resurrection. Betty Jean, God's precious gift to John Frey and his wife Katie Nee Sintner, was born in White Butte, South Dakota on September 7, 1934. She was the seventh in a family of 3 1/2 dozen kids, 3 boys and 6 girls. She was united in Christ's death and his resurrection through baptism on September 30, 1934 in White Butte, South Dakota. She lived on the family's farm near White Butte until 1941, when the family moved to a farm near Morristown, South Dakota, where she completed grade school. She attended church regularly with her family, and in 1948 was confirmed in the Christian faith. Because her parents made Christian education a high priority, Betty and her 8 siblings all attended high school at Northwestern Lutheran Academy in Mobridge, South Dakota. 1 Corinthians 15, second half of 3 and verse 4. Christ died for our sins in accordance with the scriptures. He was buried. He was raised on the third day in accordance with the scriptures. Betty worked for the telephone company as a switchboard operator during and following high school. Shortly thereafter, the Lord blessed her with the gift of a Christian husband, Norman Oster, whom she met while attending high school. They were married on June 14, 1953, and together established a Christ-centered home farming near Buchanan, North Dakota, where they raised their 8 sons. In 1977, due to Norman's declining health, they moved to Eau Claire, compelled to have all their children attend Emanuelson High School to strengthen their love for their Savior. On November 17, 1986, the Savior kept his promise and granted Norman the gift of eternal life. During the years that followed, Betty expanded her Bible teaching at home to include teaching Sunday school, teaching Vacation Bible School, and 4 years of teaching kindergarten at Messiah Lutheran School in Eau Claire. On June 21, 1992, the Lord added the gift of another Christian husband when she and Pastor Paul F. Nolting were married. Together they shared the Word of God in their Christ-centered marriage until the Lord Jesus also gave Paul the gift of eternal life on March 22, 2005. John 10:27 to 28. My sheep hear my voice. I know them, and they follow me. I give them eternal life, and they will never perish. No one will snatch them out of my hand. In addition to learning about and sharing the message of the Good Shepherd, Betty enjoyed quilting, playing Scrabble, and spending time with her children, 34 grandchildren, and 63 great-grandchildren. The Lord blessed her with good health for most of her life, and she was able to live on her own before moving to Heatherwood Assisted Living in June 19, 2019. She continued to attend church services faithfully with her family until about 4 weeks ago, when her health began to deteriorate. The Savior then gave Betty the same special gift of eternal life. She died peacefully on April 6th, surrounded by a number of her family members. Her earthly pilgrimage was 89 years, 6 months, and 30 days. Her body was cremated and placed at Forest Hill Cemetery, where it awaits its resurrection, guaranteed by the Savior's resurrection. John 11, 25, Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me will live, even if he dies. Betty was preceded in death by her parents, her husband Norman Oster, her husband Paul F. Nolting, daughter Ruth Ahrens, brother Harold and wife Millie, brother Alfred and Vera Jean, brother Norman and wife Ella, sister Dorothy Kurth, sister Dorothy and husband Donald Ragenberg, sister Catherine and husband John Hinker, sister Barbara and husband Alfred Homray, brother-in-law Bob Homray, sister-in-law Erman Wamhoff, Ernest Smith, Fiona Seals, and Delora Tarno. Yet in the time of grace, to study the scriptures and learn of Jesus the Savior, her son Glenn and his wife Harriet of Lexington, South Carolina, and their three children and 11 grandchildren. Her son Dennis and his wife Chris of Eau Claire, Wisconsin, and their three daughters and 10 grandchildren. Her son Dave and his wife Mary of Sioux Falls, South Dakota, and their two sons. Her son John Oster of Eau Claire, Wisconsin. Her son Dan and his wife Kelly of Dallas, Texas. Her son Phil and his wife Cheryl of San Juan Capistrano, California, and their two children and three grandchildren. Her son Darren and his wife Kathy of Eau Claire, Wisconsin, and their eight children and six grandchildren. Her son Gerald and his wife Anya of Eau Claire, and their four children and seven grandchildren. Her son-in-law Dennis Ahrens and his wife Carol of Valentine, and their four daughters and six grandchildren. Her daughter Sue and her husband Steve Lentz of Eau Claire, Wisconsin, and their two children and four grandchildren. Her son Paul Nolting and his wife Sarah of Valentine, Nebraska, and their four children and 15 grandchildren. Her daughter Beth and her husband Mark Kranz of Eau Claire, and their two sons and one granddaughter. Her sister Margie Wagner and her husband Elmer Wagner. Her brother-in-law Bob Kurth. Her sister-in-law Gladys Schultz. And a great number of relatives in the extended family and many friends in her church family. John 11:26, Jesus said, "And whoever lives and believes in me will never perish." Do you believe this? We continue singing selected verses from hymn 200. word of God that has been chosen to be laid upon your hearts as we celebrate our Savior's resurrection victory and Betty's victory in Christ is first found in John 10, 14 through 18 and 27 to 29. Jesus is our good shepherd who lays down his life for us and takes it up again to assure us of a resurrection to eternal life with him. We read God's word. I am the good shepherd, and I know my sheep, and am known by my own. As the shepherd knows me, even so I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. And other sheep I have which are not of this fold, them also I must bring, and they will hear my voice, and there will be one flock and one shepherd. Therefore my Father loves me because I lay down my life that I may take it again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of myself. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it again. This command I have received from my Father. My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. And I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish. Neither shall anyone snatch them out of my Father's hand, my hand. My Father, who has given them to me, is greater than all, and no one is able to snatch them out of my Father's hand. The next two sections of Scripture are ones which Betty herself chose to be read at this time. The first from Romans 8, 31 to 39. The Apostle Paul reminds us that since God the Father did not spare his own Son, who is now exalted at his right hand, not even the crosses or trials which Betty bore in her life were able to separate her from God's love. We read God's word. What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own Son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Who shall bring a charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is it he who condemns? It is Christ who died and furthermore is also risen, who is even at the right hand of God, who also makes intercession for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? As it is written, for your sakes we are killed all day long. We are counted as sheep for the slaughter. Yet in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am persuaded that neither present nor things present nor things to come, that neither death nor life, nor angels nor principalities nor powers, nor things present nor things to come, nor height nor depth, nor any other created thing shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus, our Lord. The second section that Betty chose is from Ephesians 2, 4 through 10. Here the Apostle Paul brings us the good news of God's act of making us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. We were totally undeserving, but God provided salvation through Jesus. In a few moments, we'll be singing hymn 778 based on these words. We read God's word. But God, who is rich in mercy because of his great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you've been saved. And raised us up together and made us sit together in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Then in the ages to come, he might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. This next section are some of the last words that I read to Betty before she was taken to be with the Lord, 1 Peter 1, 3 through 9. In the original, this is really one long sentence. One commentator wrote of these words, "This is a river of glory given to God for his greatness and great gifts to undeserving people. There is perhaps no paragraph in all of Scripture that can give more comfort to a suffering or dying Christian." We read God's word. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his abundant mercy has begotten us again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled and that does not fade away, reserved in heaven for you, who are kept by the power of God through faith for salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while, if need be, you have been grieved by various trials, that the genuineness of your faith, being much more precious than gold that perishes, though it is tested by fire, may be found to praise, honor, and glory at the revelation of Jesus Christ, whom having not seen, you love. Though now you do not see him, yet believing, you rejoice with joy inexpressible and full of glory, receiving the end of your faith, the salvation of your souls. And the last section was read to Betty's family on Saturday morning, just hours before Betty's passing, 1 Thessalonians 4:13 to 18. The Apostle Paul speaks of the blessed assurance of the resurrection on the last day when Jesus the Christ will descend and meet his believers in the air. We read God's word. But I do not want you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning those who have fallen asleep, lest you sorrow as others who have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so God will bring with him those who sleep in Jesus. For this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will by no means precede those who are asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, and with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and thus we shall always be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort one another with these words. We'll continue with the singing of hymn 778.
Every word of God is pure, and all Scripture has been given by inspiration of the Holy Spirit for our instruction in righteousness. That portion which forms the basis for our victory service, selected verses from Daniel chapter 3. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered and said to the king, O Nebuchadnezzar, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, and he will deliver us from your hand, O king. Then King Nebuchadnezzar was astonished, saying to his counselors, Did we not cast three men bound into the midst of the fire? Look, he answered, I see four men loose, walking in the midst of the fire, and they are not hurt, and the form of the fourth is like the Son of God. So far, our text. In Christ Jesus, who was alive, and then was dead, is now alive forevermore, grace and peace be unto you. Dear members of Messiah, family and friends of Betty, and especially on this occasion, dear children, dear grandchildren and great-grandchildren, Dennis, Carol, Mark and Beth, Steve and Sue, and through live streaming, Paul and Sarah, Glenn and Harriet, Dennis and Chris, Dave and Mary, John, Phil, Dan, Gerald and Anya, and Darren and Kathy. Our text is the three men in the fiery furnace, and it really boils down to three men and a Savior. Let's back up for a moment and pick up what the previous was happening to this. Nebuchadnezzar was the king, and he decided came up with just a dumb idea. But he came up with this idea, he's going to make a golden statue, and everybody's going to have to bow down and pray to it. It was an enormous statue. Scripture tells us that it was 90 feet tall. That'd be three times about the height of our sanctuary. 9 feet wide. It was made of gold. And Nebuchadnezzar sent out throughout the country the message, everybody's to come, everybody's to gather, all the high and mighty. And he used the sound of the trumpet. Well, actually, he used the sound more of a trumpet, more than just a trumpet. He used all kinds of instruments to signal this great event. And at the sound, they were all supposed to bow down to this particular statue that he had fashioned out of his own head. There were three Christians there that day, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And they said, we're not bowing down to an idol. That's not the God that we serve. That idol can't do anything. Our God can do anything and everything. So they didn't bow down, and some of the people around them saw it, and they were kind of spying on them and reported it to the king, and the king got them in front of them, and he said, maybe you didn't understand this, but you're supposed to bow down when the trumpet sounds. And here, I'll tell you what, I'll give you one more chance to think about it. And then comes the words of our text. Basically, they said, we don't need any more time to think about this. Our God, whom we serve, is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, and he will deliver us from your hand, O King. It's interesting how they worded that. They said, our God is able to deliver us from the fire. We don't know if he will, but we know he can. And we know this for sure, he will deliver us from your hand, O King. In the verses that follow, this made Nebuchadnezzar really mad. I mean, we're talking about really mad. He was so hot that he decided he would heat the fire up in the furnace 7 times to what it was usually heated up at. And he said, we're going to wrap those three guys with their clothing and everything. We're going to tie them all up, and we're going to throw them into that furnace, and we'll see about that God that they talk about. And the men that opened the furnace to throw them in, the Holy Spirit describes them as some of the strongest in the nation. They died from the blast that came out of the furnace. And then you know how the story unfolds. As Nebuchadnezzar peers into the furnace, he sees these three men, but they're walking around. And then he sees a fourth, like the Son of God. And then he commands them to come out, so they come out of the furnace. And then the Holy Spirit gives us kind of some amazing details. Their clothing wasn't burned. In fact, they didn't even smell of smoke. That was one, to me, is one of the more amazing statistics. Sometimes I would go off to visit members who smoked, and when I came home, I think you could kind of tell I was visiting one of those members because my clothing would smell. But they're in the midst of this fire, and they don't even smell smoke, and their hair isn't singed, and there's nothing wrong with their clothing, because they have a God who can deliver. Three men and a Savior. Betty spoke to me about three men that she considered great blessings in her life. Her father, her husband Norman, and her husband Paul. And so I'd like to apply this three men and a Savior from Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego to Betty, three men and a Savior. The first man, her father John. John treasured this gift of a baby that God had sent to the family, number 7. And he loved her a lot, but he recognized as much as he loved her, his love wasn't strong enough to get her past a day like this. He recognized that he could provide for her body and help her with her soul, but he had to go to someone else to find someone who his love was stronger. And he took her to, as Shadrach did, so John knew who to take her to. He took her to Jesus. And you heard about her baptism. And you heard about her confirmation. And you heard about her regular Bible study and her church attendance. And you heard about the sacrifice the family made so she could go to Lutheran High School. The love of her father was not strong enough, but he turned to Jesus, whose love was strong enough to conquer death. That high school education led her to meet the second man of her life, Norman Oster. And they got married. And few people know this as much as a pastor, but one of the things that you hear that we have in our agenda, which is the book we use for marrying people, that occurs again and again, is the topic of death. You'll keep yourself faithful as long as you live until death parts you. That topic of death was on Norman's mind. And he knew that as much as he loved his wife, his love wasn't strong enough to get her past this day. So like Meshach, Norman knew where to turn. He turned to the Savior Jesus. And they had Bible study. And they went to church regularly. And they partook of the Lord's Supper. He didn't know it, but his need of Jesus to overcome death would come before hers in 1986. And that led her to the third man, Paul Nolting. By this time, both of them are well acquainted with the topic of death. They each have lost a beloved spouse to death. They lost parents to death. They lost family members to death. Pastor Nolting dealt in the ministry where he had to deal with the topic of death with his members and his congregation. And they're well aware of that. And as much as he loved Betty, he, like Abednego, had to turn to someone else whose love was even stronger. And he turned and took her to the Savior and continued devotions and church attendance and communion and did not realize, but he would need that Savior first in 2005. Three men and a Savior. Three men who loved Betty a lot, but three men whose love for Betty couldn't get past this day of death. And each of them turned to the love of Jesus, whose love conquered death. How strong was the love of the Savior? Well, we don't have enough time here, and we'll be spending all of eternity talking about how strong that love was. But that love took Jesus from perfect life of heaven to come to the imperfect life here on earth. It took Jesus, who knew no sin, to be made sin for us. It took Jesus, the creator of heaven and earth, to go to the cross to die. That's how strong that love was. And the Holy Spirit uses very powerful terms to describe Jesus. It says to us, death is swallowed up in victory. Death is swallowed up in victory. Elsewhere, the Savior abolished death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. Abolished, he put out of action, he decommissioned, he rendered ineffective. He took on flesh and blood so he could destroy the one who had the power of death over us. He promises that the last enemy to be destroyed for each of us is death. Listen to those terms the Holy Spirit uses. Jesus destroyed death, abolished death, swallowed up death in victory, and destroyed the devil's power of death over us. That's the love of the Savior. And that's the love that could take Betty where the love of a father, love of a husband could not take her, to give her victory over death itself. I'd like to change the theme for a moment. And instead of three men and a savior, go to one woman and a savior. I was with the family at the funeral home, and at the funeral home, they ask you a whole bunch of questions. And one of the questions they ask you is, how would you describe her occupation? Because the government would like to know, keep track of people as they die, what line of work were they in? And so the family was pondering, how would we describe this? And one thought was, well, how about a homemaker? And another thought was, well, how about a teacher? I have my own answer. I didn't give it to them then, and I don't think the government's interested in it. But my answer was Christian missionary. Because you see, she loved each of you as well. And she knew her love for you wasn't strong enough to get you past her death day or your death day. And so what did she do? She talked to you about Jesus. She taught students in Sunday school, Vacation Bible School, and in our kindergarten classroom here about Jesus. In fact, she used this very story of the three men in the fiery furnace to tell them about the love of a Savior that is extremely powerful. And my son was one of those students that she taught. And in a way, she's taught all of you here by teaching these eight here as it gets taught to the next generation. And while she's not here today to speak to you directly, she is here today as we gather to tell you this much. I love you, but my love isn't strong enough. You need to have the love of the Savior. Turn to Him. And in that Savior, you will find love that's strong enough to give you a victory over death itself. She'd say to you, listen to Jesus. Study about Jesus. Follow Jesus. Believe in Jesus. And then someday, I'll be able to introduce you to three men, John, Norman, and Paul. Oh, we'll also get to introduce you to Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And we'll take an opportunity to praise Jesus for his love and to talk with him in heaven forever. Amen. Our service continues with a hymn. You'll find it in the bulletin. We're not singing stanza three without the organ. Stanza three kind of deals with the humiliation of the Savior. We get a chance to have the organ join us on stanza four and five with the exaltation of the Savior. Let us pray. We thank you, Lord Jesus Christ, that you have taken Betty away from all the distress and evils of this world and have brought her into eternal rest in heaven. O dear Savior, we say with Job, the Lord gave and the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. And with the people in the Gospels, Jesus has done all things well. Enable us to comfort ourselves with the consideration that we have not lost Betty, but have only sent her before, no wise doubting that on the last day you will raise up with power and great glory the body that was last seen by us in such great weakness, and that we shall find one another again with you in eternal life. Give to each of us here this day the grace of your Holy Spirit, that we can, at this victory service, we may call to mind how soon it is all over with us frail human beings, and be found in constant and never-failing Christian readiness to follow you when the hour is at hand through the dark valley of death into your kingdom with exceeding great joy. You, the one who reigns with the Father and the Holy Spirit forever and ever. Amen. Betty had requested that her son Paul would sing the Lord's Prayer. He wasn't able to be with us today in person, but we do have his recording made earlier this week. Our service continues with his singing of the Lord's Prayer. Following our closing hymn, the family invites you to join them for a luncheon and an opportunity to review some picture, the life of Betty. That'll be taking place in just a few moments. In anticipation of that meal, we come to the Lord with asking for his blessing now. Dear Lord Jesus, we thank you for the food that you have prepared and that we are about to receive. May it refresh us in our bodies. And that having been refreshed through that meal with our bodies, and refreshed in our souls through the word you've given us this day, we may be with renewed zeal take up the mission you have given to us, to go and tell the Savior lives. As we rejoice in your great victory over death, we are reminded of how many do not yet know. Send us out, send that word out, and blessed is the salvation of many. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace. Amen.